Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jeff Kadosky.
Welcome to day two of NI Week 2012. We're all familiar with the benefits of Moore's Law and our consumer electronic devices, familiar to the point we take it for granted that all kinds of electronic products continue to get faster while getting smaller, taking less power, and costing less. And yesterday we showed how instrumentation can and should follow Moore's Law too. In fact, that's a key strategy of our platform-based approach to serving engineers and scientists. Moore's Law continues to hold today, but that belies a paradigm shift happening behind the scenes. It's no longer practical to increase clock speeds to achieve higher performance, so chip designers are adding multiple cores. And this is changing the way software must be designed. To use the multiple cores effectively, software has to operate them in parallel. From one perspective, it seems odd to think that parallelism would be such a concern. Why would it be difficult? We're immersed in parallel activities all the time, like walking and talking, driving in traffic, playing sports, and so on. But not only are we accustomed to doing things in parallel, we've also been describing and designing parallel systems for a long time. All kinds of parallel systems in all realms of endeavor. Electrical engineers design parallel electronic circuit systems using circuit diagrams. All the components operate continuously in parallel, and the designer specifies how they interact by using the parallel notation of a circuit diagram. Physicists describe the complex interactions of particles by using Feynman diagrams. The propagation and scattering of particles is represented graphically, and the computational result is the sum over many diagrams acting in parallel. Music composers have been using diagrammatic notation for hundreds of years. It represents the musical lines of all the players in an orchestra as they coordinate their playing in parallel. Project planners use a variety of diagrams like PERT charts and Gantt charts to specify and manage all the parallel activities of groups involved in large construction projects. Even football coaches use diagrams to describe the parallel actions of players during a football play. Professional programmers build parallel software systems using threads, mutexes, and text-based sequential programming languages. Really? Is that the best we can do? Well, actually, there's a better way, and it's called graphical system design, using the parallel graphical notation of LabVIEW to design systems. Graphical system design is particularly powerful when your application needs to run on heterogeneous distributed multi-core processors, or FPGAs, or when it needs to do real-time I/O, or high-speed streaming, or precision timing, or synchronous I/O on many channels. In short, whenever your application needs to do real-world measurement or control. The heart of graphical system design is the LabVIEW development environment. We've expanded the scope and capability of LabVIEW enormously over the last 26 years, and we still are. But there are core principles that have remained unchanged since LabVIEW's inception and which continue to guide its evolution. These principles are not necessarily obvious, and their combination certainly isn't, but they arose from some basic general observations and have stood the test of time. In the 1970s, working for Dr. T at Applied Research Labs, I wrote a variety of measurement programs on programmable calculators connected to various instruments. The largest system ran on a network of three PDP-11 computers and connected to power amplifiers, relay switch panels, motors, state-of-the-art instruments, and A to D converters. The system was designed to test all the Navy's underwater transducers using high-powered pulse measurements. The measurements involved controlling motors to plot beam patterns, sweeping frequency to measure amplitude response, sweeping power to measure linearity, and so on, for more than 20 types of measurements defined for hundreds of different types of acoustic transducers. Since these signals were pulse signals, it was important to sample the stable part of the pulse past the initial transient, but before the interference from reflections appeared. The software had heuristics to find this stable region, but to verify this and to fine-tune it if necessary, the system had an oscilloscope that could show the raw waveforms in the sample windows. The oscilloscope was also useful for checking proper operation under normal conditions and was invaluable in diagnosing problems with the transducer under test or the measurement system itself. The design of the software for this system was challenging, particularly given the limitations of the computers and development tools of the time. But there were two particular aspects of the system that figured prominently in the genesis of LabVIEW. The first was that the system software was constructed as a hierarchy of subsystems, analogous to the way the hardware was constructed. The second was that the data in the software hierarchy were available for inspection, analogous to the waveforms on the oscilloscope. In fact, I thought of the software for this system as a hierarchy of virtual instruments, although at the time, it was just an abstraction. It wasn't until years later, when the Macintosh computer was introduced, that it became clear that graphics could turn the virtual instrument abstraction into something more meaningful. Graphical panels would make the software virtual instruments more clearly analogous to real instruments, and graphical panels would also make the software modules just as intuitive to operate. The Macintosh computer came along at an opportune time. NI was a successful supplier of GPIB interfaces connecting instruments to computers, and we were looking to help customers with the next level problem, namely automating their measurement systems. Making measurements is an inherently complex task, but automating a measurement system introduces even more complexity, artificial complexity, due to the limitations of the tools being used. We wanted to reduce the artificial complexity in much the same way that spreadsheets reduce the complexity of financial analysis, by working at a higher level of abstraction. Using graphical panels for virtual instruments would make the software easy to use, but a lot harder to program. Was there a way that the graphics capability of the Mac could make programming easier as well? The solution embodied more of the principles at the core of LabVIEW. There are lots of diagrams used by designers, like state diagrams, flow charts, and data flow diagrams, and I looked at all of those and more. But data flow diagrams were the most natural and easiest to understand, and they required the least amount of text to be meaningful. The bivalue semantics gave data flow diagrams rigorous mathematical properties and made analysis much easier than with other diagrams. A data flow diagram is a minimal specification for computation, not overconstrained with unnecessary sequencing. And operations act locally, so there isn't the artificial complexity of dealing with global state, something that confounds traditional languages even today, and it's getting worse with the move to multi-core machines. There was one stumbling block to using data flow diagrams as a programming methodology, however, and I thought it was serious enough to make the endeavor useless unless I could come up with a way around it. Looping or iteration is a key need in most stimulus response measurements. Standard data flow diagrams represent iteration with a cycle in the diagram. This doesn't sound like a big issue at first, but it actually adds a lot of artificial complexity to the diagram. The February 1982 issue of the IEEE Computer Magazine was devoted to data flow programming and data flow machines. One article was particularly interesting, not only because of what it said, but because of an error in a simple example. The example diagram depicted a program employing Newton's method to home in on the root of an equation. It uses a single loop represented by a cycle in the diagram. To get the cycle to work properly, one has to introduce extra concepts like the existence of data tokens that stick around indefinitely, as well as nodes that have weaker execution rules, some that execute without having all their inputs present, and some that only produce a subset of their outputs. The result is a diagram that is much harder to analyze, even more difficult to construct correctly. And this was brought home to me by the error in this example, which inadvertently reversed the outputs of the distributor node, resulting in an incorrect calculation and deadlock. So standard data flow was an ideal model of computation, at least until one had to add cycles to represent iteration. The solution I came up with instead was to combine data flow and so-called structured programming. Structured programming is a methodology invented to rein in the chaos of unrestrained go-to statements, which were prevalent in early languages like BASIC and Fortran. Structured programming elevated loops and conditionals to first-class language elements, rather than being composed of lower-level go-to statements. Structured programming is well understood, straightforward to analyze, and is a feature of all modern languages. The insight that structures could be represented as boxes in a data flow diagram was what made LabVIEW possible. The core principle that underlies LabVIEW's language G is structured data flow. Acyclic diagrams in which data flows by value, nodes have no side effects, and the higher order semantics of loops and conditionals are encapsulated by boxes that separate the inside of the structure from the outside. Here is the same Newton's method example using structured data flow. The loop is represented by a box, feedback is accomplished with the shift register, the body of the loop is clearly separated from the outside, and there's no possibility of deadlock because the loop is not constructed from more primitive components which might be connected incorrectly. Structured data flow is an elegant model of computation with a simple but rigorously defined semantics. However, right off the bat, we had to compromise on some of its principles in order to create practical applications. Obviously, I/O nodes have side effects, and for practical reasons, it's useful to have some form of global data and some limited by reference access to non-local data, including files. But to the extent that these compromises can be minimized, the resulting applications will be easier to construct, analyze, understand, modify, and maintain. LabVIEW 1 was an interpreter, moving data tokens around the data flow diagram, following a literal and elementary strategy for execution. As a result, it was able to accurately model the parallelism of the diagram, although the execution performance was slow. On the other hand, the availability and responsiveness was high. A user could make a change to the program and rerun it immediately, which greatly facilitated rapid incremental development. LabVIEW 2 had a compiler, so it could achieve much higher execution performance, but designing a compiler was a challenge for several reasons. We had to reduce memory copies implied by data flow, and we had to reduce scheduling overhead by clumping together nodes where their individual, possibly parallel execution was not explicitly observable. In addition to these challenges, we felt it was necessary to preserve the rapid prototyping capability that LabVIEW 1 had. Ideally, the compiler should not even be visible to the user, since from his perspective, it would only be an artificial complexity to deal with. He should be able to make a change, hit the run button, and not even notice we had to recompile. We were largely successful in achieving this, but the challenge we face today is to continue to improve the performance of the compiled code without lengthening the time to compile. The core principles embodied in LabVIEW are the foundation for its success. Graphical structured data flow combines the accessibility of graphics, the simplicity and inherent parallelism of data flow, the disciplined abstraction of structured programming, and the scalability of hierarchical composition. Every virtual instrument module has a built-in user interface which unifies programmatic and interactive use of the module, simplifies unit testing, and facilitates debugging. Diagrams have less artificial complexity than typical text language syntax, not to mention the semantics. Visual feedback during editing catches mistakes early, and built-in debugging capabilities like execution highlighting facilitate learning by discovery. Fast compile time enables rapid prototyping and short cycle times for incremental development. So I'd like to conclude with some observations about the software architecture of the vector signal transceiver we introduced yesterday. It's a case study in the right way to program a heterogeneous parallel high-performance system, namely through graphical system design using LabVIEW. The foundation of the transceiver is a set of instrument design libraries, or building blocks, which provide all the functionality of the instrument. These libraries are independently implemented so they can be composed as desired. They can be used or left out or modified individually, easily adding custom IP when needed, because of the well-defined interfaces between the libraries. It's also possible to add a custom library, for instance, to control a device under test through a digital port. This architecture represents the ultimate disaggregation of traditional instrumentation, down to the most basic components, so they can be recomposed to create precise measurement capability needed per application. Each of the basic building blocks spans the CPU and the FPGA interface, with LabVIEW used to design each portion. The design is open and understandable by both hardware engineers and programmers. In addition to the basic building blocks, there's an application framework or sample project for typical stimulus response test applications. On top of this are two working test applications, one for 802.11ac testing and one for power amplifier testing. There are many ways the instrument design libraries can be used, and we have identified another common application pattern. So in addition to the test framework, we've also provided a high-speed streaming application framework. On top of this are two working streaming applications, one for channel emulation and one for high-speed disk streaming. All of these applications work out of the box, are completely open and modifiable, and they are excellent starting points for creating a total custom solution for test, for design, or both. We refer to this overall architecture as software design instrumentation, or LabVIEW to the pin, as I like to call it, because it's completely implemented in LabVIEW and open from top to bottom. You can drill all the way down to where the I/O pins on the FPGA are being wiggled. You have unprecedented flexibility to customize your instrumentation and make exactly the measurement you need. The vector signal transceiver is so flexible and powerful that if it were a car, we would be talking about it as a sleek, highly maneuverable sports car with ultra-high performance. But there's even more to the vector signal transceiver. In addition to the LabVIEW to the pin architecture I just described, we've also built a pair of full-featured traditional instruments, one for signal generation and the other for signal analysis. Both are built as LabVIEW DLLs and leverage the same instrument design libraries, so the same high performance is available. However, the traditional instrument architecture can't capture the full capability of the vector signal transceiver. The traditional interfaces simply don't have the flexibility that's expressible in the LabVIEW to the pin architecture. We built the traditional instrument architecture specifically for backwards compatibility with traditional box instruments. It lets the vector signal transceiver play well with existing applications and be called easily from C and C++. Not everyone is ready to or able to adopt our revolutionary new instrumentation paradigm, so our traditional instrument architecture provides a comfortably familiar interface with no extra learning curve, and you still get high performance. The vector signal transceiver development team has achieved a major milestone and in the process kicked off the next revolution in instrumentation. All the software is written in LabVIEW. They have proven by construction that LabVIEW is capable of designing the highest performance instrumentation on the planet. It's never been more true that the software is the instrument. It's been an incredible journey from the fledgling LabVIEW of 26 years ago to the powerful graphical system design environment of today. And it's particularly exciting to realize there is much more still to come. Thank you.